Kalorama, a Recorded Books Highbridge imprint, presents Spies, Lies, and Algorithms, The History and Future of American Intelligence by Amy B. Zegart. Read by Amy B. Zegart. For my children, Alexander, Jack, and Kate, and for Craig, always. Chapter 1. Intelligence Challenges in the Digital Age. Cloaks, Daggers, and Tweets. In June 2014, I was scrolling through my Twitter feed when I came across the following tweet. We can neither confirm nor deny that this is our first tweet. At first, I thought it was a joke. The Central Intelligence Agency, or CIA, is notoriously secretive. So shadowy, even its public affairs officers don't always tell you their names. But the tweet was real. America's cloak and dagger agency had finally joined the social media age. The internet went wild. Who knew they have a sense of humor, reported CNN. The CIA's Twitter debut was a lighthearted moment in a darkening landscape. New technologies such as AI, artificial intelligence, internet connectivity, quantum computing, and synthetic biology are disrupting global economics and politics at unprecedented speed. Never before has the United States faced a more dynamic and dangerous world. For the CIA and the 17 other agencies comprising the IC, the U.S. intelligence community, this is a moment of reckoning. Artificial intelligence is transforming both commerce and defense in ways that could destabilize social orders and alter the global distribution of power. Computer scientist Kai-Fu Lee estimates that AI could eliminate up to 40% of jobs worldwide in the next 15 to 25 years, in sectors ranging from trucking to the service industry. AI is also poised to revolutionize how wars are fought, automating everything from logistics to cyber defenses to unmanned fighter jets that can sense and attack faster than humans. As former Google CEO Eric Schmidt and former Deputy Secretary of Defense Robert Warrick wrote, AI is accelerating innovation in every scientific and engineering endeavor. Not since electricity has a breakthrough technology ushered in so much potential promise and peril. Russian President Vladimir Putin has declared that whoever leads in AI development will become the ruler of the world. More than a dozen countries have launched national AI initiatives, and China has made no secret of its plans to become the global leader in AI by 2030, part of its strategy to challenge U.S. economic and military dominance. American experts and policymakers are sounding the alarm. We are in a strategic competition. AI will be at the center. The future of our national security and economy are at stake, noted the bipartisan National Security Commission on Artificial Intelligence in a 2019 report. AI isn't the only technology reshaping the world. Internet connectivity is supercharging politics, fueling protest movements like the Arab Spring and Hong Kong's umbrella movement, repressive crackdowns like China's persecution of the Uyghurs, and Russian information warfare campaigns that reach deep into the societies of other nations. The so-called Internet of Things, everyday devices with internet connections, is spreading to billions of toys, cars, appliances, and more, and bringing cyber vulnerabilities with it. Facebook algorithms are deciding what news we read and influencing how we think, enabling the manipulation of populations at scale. There is greater upheaval still to come. In 2019, Google announced it had achieved quantum supremacy, a computing breakthrough so powerful that a math problem a supercomputer would need 10,000 years to solve could be cracked by its machine in just 3 minutes and 20 seconds. Experts likened it to the Wright brothers' first flight, the dawn of a technological era opening vast new possibilities. Not all of them are good. Quantum computing could eventually unlock the encryption protecting nearly all of the world's data today. Synthetic biology is enabling scientists to engineer living organisms and create new ones not found in nature, with the potential for revolutionary improvements in the production of food, medicines, and data storage, as well as new weapons of war. Because living cells are programmable like computers, they could eventually be engineered to make just about anything. Potential uses include manufacturing plastics, creating plants that can detect chemical munitions by changing color, and even designing bioweapons that target individuals on the basis of their DNA. Here, too, Chinese military leaders have made innovation a top priority, calling biotech the new strategic commanding heights of national defense. The COVID-19 pandemic accelerated many of these trends, sending entire economies and societies online and fueling the use of biosurveillance technologies like smart jewelry that tracks symptoms and data analytics that can identify which rooms of a building an infected person used and whether they were wearing a face mask. We've seen technological advances before, but never have we seen the convergence of so many new technologies changing so much so fast. This moment is challenging American intelligence agencies in three profound ways. First, technological breakthroughs are transforming the threat landscape by generating new uncertainties and empowering new adversaries. During the Cold War, America had one principal enemy, the Soviet Union. The Cold War was a dangerous time, but it was simpler. America's top intelligence priority was clear. Every foreign policy decision was viewed through the lens of, what would Moscow think? Now, a wide array of bad actors is leveraging technology to threaten across vast distances. China is launching massive cyber attacks to steal American intellectual property and building space weapons to cut off U.S. military satellite communications before the fighting ever starts. Russia is using Facebook, Twitter, and other social media platforms to wage information warfare. 36 countries have autonomous combat drones, and at least 9 have already used them. Terrorist groups are using online video games to recruit followers and Google Earth to plan their attacks. Despots in developing nations are employing high-tech repression tools. Weak states and non-state actors can inflict massive disruption, destruction, and deception with the click of a mouse. For most of history, power and geography provided security. The strong threatened the weak, not the other way around. Oceans protected countries from one another, and distance mattered. Not anymore. In this era, the United States is simultaneously powerful and vulnerable to a head-spinning number of dangers, all moving at the speed of networks. It's a far cry from the plodding pace of Soviet 5-year plans from a few decades ago. The second challenge of the digital age involves data. Intelligence is a sense-making enterprise. Agencies like the CIA gather and analyze information to help policymakers understand the present and anticipate the future. Intelligence isn't always right, but it beats the best alternatives, guesswork, opinion, and gut feel. In the old days, spy agencies in a handful of powerful countries dominated the collection and analysis of information. They were the only organizations with the resources and know-how to build billion-dollar satellites, make and break sophisticated codes, and collect information at scale. In 2001, the NSA, the National Security Agency, intercepted about 200 million foreign emails, phone calls, and other signals a day. Few countries or companies could come close. Now, data is democratizing, and American spy agencies are struggling to keep up. More than half the world is online, conducting 5 billion Google searches each day. Cell phone users are recording and posting events in real time, turning everyone into intelligence collectors, whether they know it or not. Anyone with an internet connection can access Google Earth satellite imagery, identify people using facial recognition software, and track events on Twitter. On January 6, 2021, when pro-Trump rioters violently attacked the U.S. Capitol to prevent congressional certification of the 2020 presidential election, causing the deaths of five people, online sleuths immediately started mining images and video posted on social media to help law enforcement agencies identify the perpetrators. One anonymous college student even created a website called Faces of the Riot. Using widely available facial detection software, the student scanned hundreds of videos and thousands of pictures shared by rioters and others on the social media site Parler and extracted images of those who may have been involved in the Capitol siege. The sheer volume of online data today is so staggering, it's hard to comprehend. In 2019, internet users posted 500 million tweets, sent 294 billion emails, and posted 350 million photos on Facebook every day. Some estimate that the amount of information on Earth is doubling every 2 years. This kind of publicly available information is called open source intelligence, and it is becoming increasingly valuable. When U.S. Navy SEALs conducted their secret nighttime raid on Osama bin Laden's Pakistani compound, Pakistan's military didn't detect a thing, but a local information technology consultant named Sohaib Utter did. Hearing strange noises, he took to Twitter. "Helicopter hovering above Abbottabad at 1 a.m. is a rare event," he posted. Utter ended up live-tweeting the operation, including reporting when an explosion shook his windows. Similarly, when Russia invaded Ukraine in 2014, the best evidence did not come from spies or secretly intercepted communications. It came from selfies, time-stamped photos taken by Russian soldiers and posted on social media with Ukrainian highway signs in the background. Social media has become so important, even the consoles at America's underground nuclear command center display Twitter feeds alongside classified information feeds. That's not all. Commercial firms worldwide are launching hundreds of small satellites every year, offering low-cost eyes in the sky to anyone who wants them. Some satellite sensors have resolutions so sharp they can detect manhole covers from space. Others can capture images at night, in cloudy weather, or through dense vegetation and camouflage. And constellations of cheap small satellites are offering something new, faster revisit rates over the same location to detect changes over time. Already, commercial imagery and machine learning tools are enabling some of my Stanford colleagues to analyze North Korea's trade relationship with China by counting the number of trucks crossing the border in hundreds of images over the past 5 years. Commercial imagery is becoming so valuable that the National Reconnaissance Office, the American agency that builds and operates spy satellites, is spending $300 million a year to buy it rather than just building satellites of its own. In short, data volume and accessibility are revolutionizing sense-making. The intelligence playing field is leveling, and not in a good way. Intelligence collectors are everywhere, and government spy agencies are drowning in data. This is a radical new world, and intelligence agencies are struggling to adapt to it. While secrets once conferred a huge advantage, today open-source information increasingly does. Intelligence used to be a race for insight where great powers were the only ones with the capabilities to access secrets. Now, everyone is racing for insight, and the internet gives them the tools to do it. Secrets still matter, but whoever can harness all this data better and faster will win. Secrecy and the origins of non-denial denials. The CIA's "we can neither confirm nor deny" response is part of the popular lexicon. While often used as a laugh line in movies or on Twitter, that non-denial denial is real. A CIA lawyer came up with it in 1975 when information about one of the agency's most highly classified covert operations leaked to the press. The operation was codenamed Azorian. It involved billionaire Howard Hughes, a CIA ship posing as a commercial deep-sea mining vessel, and a daring effort to hoist a sunken Soviet submarine, along with its nuclear missiles and secrets, from the bottom of the Pacific Ocean right as Soviet ships were passing by. At the time, Cold War tensions were high, the risks of exposure were great, and reporters were barraging CIA officials with questions. The agency did not want to be caught lying about what it was doing in the midst of Watergate, but it didn't want to reveal anything to the Soviets either. "We can neither confirm nor deny" has been used ever since. The third challenge posed by emerging technologies strikes at the heart of espionage: secrecy. Until now, American spy agencies didn't have to interact much with outsiders, and they didn't want to. The intelligence mission meant gathering secrets so we knew more about adversaries than they knew about us, and keeping how we gathered secrets a secret too. Walk into CIA headquarters and you feel it. There's a gleaming white marble memorial wall covered with more than 100 stars, each denoting an intelligence officer who died in the line of duty. A book of honor records their names, except for 40 entries that have only blank lines. For these CIA officers, service remains classified, even in death. Balancing secrecy and openness is an age-old struggle. Secrecy is vital for protecting intelligence sources and collection methods, as well as securing advantage. Openness is vital for ensuring democratic accountability. Too much secrecy invites abuse. Too much transparency makes intelligence ineffective. In the digital age, however, secrecy is bringing greater risk because emerging technologies are blurring nearly all the old boundaries of geopolitics. Increasingly, national security requires intelligence agencies to engage the outside world, not stand apart from it. It used to be that adversaries threatened from abroad and we could see them coming. Military mobilization took time. Now they can attack privately owned critical infrastructure like power grids and financial systems in cyberspace, anytime, from anywhere, without crossing a border or firing a shot. In the 20th century, economics and security politics were separate spheres because the Soviet bloc command economies were never part of the global trading order. In the 21st century, economics and security politics have become tightly intertwined because of global supply chains and dramatic advances in dual-use technologies like AI that offer game-changing commercial and military applications. Until now, intelligence agencies focused on understanding foreign governments and terrorist groups. Today, they also have to understand American tech giants and startups, and how malign actors can use our own inventions against us. Securing advantage in this new world means that intelligence agencies must find new ways to work with private sector companies to combat online threats and harness commercial technological advances. They must engage the universe of open source data to capture the power of its insights. And they must serve a broader array of intelligence customers outside of government to defend the nation. These days, the National Security Agency isn't the only big data behemoth. Amazon, Apple, Facebook, Google, and Microsoft are too. Although some companies have declared they will never use their technology for weapons, the reality is their technology already is a weapon. Hackers are attacking computer networks through Gmail phishing schemes and Microsoft coding vulnerabilities. Terrorists are live streaming attacks, and malign actors have turned social media platforms like Twitter and Facebook into disinformation superhighways that undermine democracy from within. American intelligence agencies have to find better ways to access relevant threat information held by these and other companies without jeopardizing civil liberties or firms' commercial success. Intelligence agencies need the private sector more for innovation now, too. Analyzing massive troves of data, for example, will increasingly depend on AI tools. Technological advances like the internet used to start in government and then migrate to the commercial sector. Now that process is reversed, with breakthroughs coming from large companies like Google and NVIDIA, and from startups like Ginkgo Bioworks and Dataminr. Instead of developing technologies in-house, spy agencies now have to spot and adopt them rapidly from the outside. That requires talent as well as technology, and the private sector is cornering the labor market too, offering compensation packages and cutting-edge computer facilities that are hard for government agencies or universities to match. Companies have been hiring away so many top AI professors. 41 AI faculty left academia in 2018 alone. Experts are worried there won't be enough left to teach the next generation of students. Engagement and collaboration with the private sector don't come easily. Distrust of American spy agencies has a long history, with some dark chapters. In the 1970s, revelations that intelligence agencies had been spying on Americans, infiltrating dissident groups, and assassinating foreign leaders prompted outcries and congressional oversight reforms. More recent controversies include CIA drone strikes and secret NSA surveillance programs revealed by a former agency contractor named Edward Snowden in 2013. In the summer of 2014, a year after the Snowden revelations hit the press, I held a cyber boot camp for congressional staffers that included a visit to a major Silicon Valley tech company. As we filed into the conference room, the tension was palpable. One tech executive told the group he viewed the U.S. government just like China's People's Liberation Army, as an adversary that needed to be stopped from surreptitiously penetrating his systems. Jaws dropped. An Intelligence Committee staffer rushed outside to call the boss and relay the news. They had a lot more repair work to do. NSA's surveillance programs had been authorized, but in the eyes of tech executives, they had broken faith by secretly gathering customer data and making companies look weak, complicit, or both. Intelligence agencies are still working hard to rebuild that trust. As the agency's first neither confirm nor deny tweet went viral, Director John Brennan put out a press release explaining that he wanted a social media presence to more directly engage with the public and provide information on CIA's mission, history, and other developments. When secret agencies feel the need to engage and inform, you know times are changing. It's an important beginning. Emerging technologies are also unleashing a whole new world of publicly available or open source information, from Russian soldier selfies in Ukraine to satellite images of Chinese trucks in North Korea, that is challenging the primacy of secrets and the insight they provide. While open source information has always been important, secrets have reigned supreme inside America's intelligence agencies. Not everything was secret, but secrets were everything. As former CIA analyst Aris Pappas noted, during the Cold War, it was easy to slip into the attitude of, gee, if they spent $1 trillion to get this information, it must be $1 trillion worth of information. Technological breakthroughs are even challenging ideas about who counts as a decision maker. Until now, national security policy was the province of government. Important decisions were made by federal employees who wore badges, held security clearances, and knew how the intelligence community worked. Not anymore. Increasingly, decision makers live worlds apart from Washington, making policy choices in living rooms and boardrooms, not just the White House Situation Room. They are voters targeted by foreign influence campaigns to divide society and manipulate elections. And they are executives and employees working in technology companies where rewards come from inventing new products and finding new markets, not protecting society from nefarious uses and downside risks. Leaders in these companies may want no part of American national security policy or global politics, but their decisions unavoidably affect both. In the digital age, business is not just business. Tech policy is public policy. Social media companies are deciding what presidential messages to the world can be blocked or shared. Software developers are affecting how vulnerable their global products will be to cyber attack. Cell phone and messaging app executives are making encryption decisions that determine how dissidents can operate and how law enforcement agencies can combat terrorists. Leaders on both sides of the Silicon Valley-Washington divide must navigate this new world together. They cannot do it without intelligence about how the threat landscape is shaping the development and use of new technologies, and how new technologies are shaping the threat landscape. Serving a broader set of decision makers requires much more than declassifying old intelligence reports and conducting business as usual. This was one of the chief lessons of 2016. During that election cycle, intelligence officials detected many facets of Russian interference and became so alarmed they decided to warn the public. On October 7th, the Director of National Intelligence and the Secretary of Homeland Security took the unprecedented step of issuing a joint press statement. But almost nobody noticed. Why? In part because it was written in intelligence speak. Here are the first few lines. The U.S. intelligence community, USIC, is confident that the Russian government directed the recent compromises of emails from U.S. persons and institutions, including from U.S. political organizations. The recent disclosures of alleged hacked emails on sites like DCLeaks.com and WikiLeaks and by the Guccifer 2.0 online persona are consistent with the methods and motivations of Russian-directed efforts. To intelligence insiders, the message was serious and clear. To the public, not so much. That same day, the infamous Access Hollywood audio tape, in which Republican nominee Donald Trump boasted about how easy it was for him to sexually assault women, hit the news. Guess which got more attention? In the 2020 presidential election, intelligence officials became more active and creative, making video public service announcements, issuing more frequent press releases, and granting more media interviews. One October video even included counterintelligence chief William Evanina and General Paul Nakasone, who led both the Pentagon's cyber warriors and the super snoopers of the National Security Agency. Their message? Election threats were real, but their agencies were on the job. These steps have been important, but insufficient. The 2020 video announcement, for example, received just 22,400 views on YouTube before Election Day. Russia's state-run propaganda mill, RT America, formerly called Russia Today, had more than 1 million YouTube subscribers. Meanwhile, intelligence itself became politicized, with Director of National Intelligence John Ratcliffe selectively using secrets and publicizing suspected Russian disinformation to support President Trump's campaign. I hope to give a better understanding of intelligence as well as the challenges American spy agencies now confront. There are no easy answers, but one imperative is already evident. America's intelligence agencies must adapt, or they will fail. The biggest surprise attacks in modern American history, Pearl Harbor, 9/11, and Russia's interference in the 2016 presidential election, occurred because spy organizations did not change fast or fully enough to meet emerging threats. This juncture, too, requires dramatic change to harness new technologies better and faster than adversaries do. This book draws on nearly 30 years of researching American intelligence agencies and advising the U.S. government, hundreds of interviews with current and former intelligence officials and policymakers, an undergraduate course I taught at UCLA, and focus groups I held more recently with high school and college students about what they wanted to learn about intelligence and why. It's worth noting that I am a visitor to the secret world of intelligence, not an inhabitant. Although I have served on the National Security Council staff and advised intelligence officials and policymakers, I have never worked inside an intelligence agency. I am a career academic who has examined spy agencies from the outside, looking at how they have evolved over time, why they have such a hard time adapting to new threats, and how they can improve. I often feel like an anthropologist who travels to the far reaches of Washington, D.C. to observe the foreign cultures of a rare and secret clan of people called intelligence officers. Being an outsider has both drawbacks and benefits. On the one hand, I cannot examine what the classified record actually says about pivotal intelligence events. I can only study what happened after the fact. On the other hand, an outsider's perspective can bring healthy skepticism and independence. I am freer to ask uncomfortable questions and come to unflattering conclusions than an insider would be. Chapter 2 starts by examining the crisis in intelligence education and its costs. Most Americans, including policymakers, have little idea how America's intelligence agencies actually work. Instead, fiction has played an outsized role. Years ago, a poll of my students led to a startling discovery. Spy-themed entertainment seemed to be influencing attitudes on intelligence in significant ways. This chapter follows the trail, examining my national polling project, tracing the dramatic rise in spytainment, and examining how Hollywood has fueled conspiracy theories and influenced policymakers from Supreme Court justices to soldiers on the front lines. Chapter 3 covers American espionage from 18th century invisible ink to 21st century spy satellites. That may seem like a long time, but compared to the rest of the world, American intelligence history is quite short. George Washington's spies didn't come around until 2,000 years after Chinese General Sun Tzu wrote his treatise on the use of intelligence in warfare, The Art of War. Today's vast intelligence enterprise emerged largely after World War II and reflects the country's evolving role in the world. Chapter 4 covers intelligence basics. We examine what intelligence is, what it isn't, and how it operates, with a bird's-eye view of the decade-long hunt for Osama bin Laden and personal reflections by intelligence officials of their daily lives, ethical dilemmas, and best and worst moments. Chapter 5 examines intelligence analysis and why it's so hard. From China's surprise attack in the Korean War to the mistaken reports around Iraq's weapons of mass destruction, analytic failures have common causes. Chief among them are what I call the seven deadly biases, or the cognitive traps that can lead even the smartest minds astray. We also explore the coming world of artificial intelligence, discussing which kinds of analysis machines can do better than humans, and humans can do better than machines. Chapter 6 turns to one of the most sensitive points for the intelligence community, traitors. What motivates trusted insiders to become turncoats? How can intelligence officers recruit spies in the digital age, and how can they identify possible double agents while still maintaining the trust necessary to do their work? Chapter 7 explores covert action, what former CIA Director Leon Panetta once called a hard business of agonizing choices. We start in the deserts of Yemen, where an American citizen, an infamous terrorist named Anwar al-Awlaki, was killed in a covert drone strike without a trial, judge, or jury. We explore what exactly covert action is and why all presidents use it, even though it so often fails. And we walk through one of these agonizing choices, examining a hypothetical covert action dilemma from different perspectives. In Chapter 8, we examine the contentious world of congressional oversight, how it's developed, why it matters, why it rarely works well, and what the future holds. We also delve into debates over the CIA's detention and interrogation program and the NSA's warrantless wiretapping program, two of the most heated oversight controversies in intelligence history. Chapter 9 turns to nuclear sleuthing in the digital age. Thanks to the internet, commercial satellites, and automated analytics, nuclear intelligence isn't just for superpower governments anymore. We trace the rise of the new nuclear sleuths, individuals and organizations outside of governments who are transforming how illicit nuclear activities are tracked. This new ecosystem highlights the dramatic changes in intelligence emerging today, including opportunities and risks. Chapter 10 concludes with cyber threats, what they are, how they have evolved, what they mean for intelligence, and the key challenges they raise. In many ways, cyberspace is the ultimate cloak and dagger battleground, where nefarious actors employ deception, subterfuge, and advanced technology for theft, espionage, information warfare, and more. Cyber threats are hacking both machines and minds. This is only the beginning. Artificial intelligence is creating deepfake video, audio, and photographs so real their inauthenticity may be impossible to detect. No set of threats has changed so fast and demanded so much from intelligence. For America's intelligence community, the digital age is filled with complexity and challenge. From catching traitors and understanding covert action to understanding nuclear threats and operating in cyberspace, success requires a fundamental rethink about how to secure advantage in a radically new world. It starts by getting back to basics and depoliticizing intelligence again. But success also includes a mission shift that embraces open source intelligence, develops new capabilities for both secret activities and open engagement, and rewards officials for doing things differently. As we'll see, adapting to this technological era is an enormous paradigm shift, but it's essential. Chapter 2, The Education Crisis, How Fictional Spies Are Shaping Public Opinion and Intelligence Policy. The difference between fiction and reality? Fiction has to make sense. Tom Clancy. For fans of spy movies and television shows, a visit to CIA headquarters will be disappointing. The visitor center looks nothing like the cool, high-tech offices of Jason Bourne or Carrie Matheson. Instead, the entry to America's best-known intelligence agency has more of a shabby U.S. post office feel. There are teller windows with bulletproof glass, soda machines, and an old-fashioned black landline phone mounted on the back wall. Once cleared by security, visitors head back outside, where they can walk down a winding road or take the rambling shuttle bus to the old headquarters building. There, lobby security has no retina scans or fancy fingerprint devices, just a few turnstiles, and a friendly security guard who takes cell phones and hands out paper claim checks. Even the suite of executive offices where the CIA director sits seems strangely ordinary. The only clue that this is not a typical government building is the burn bags. Because classified documents cannot just be thrown away, instead of trash cans, striped burn bags that look weirdly like Trader Joe's holiday shopping bags are scattered around the building to make incineration easier. NCTC, the National Counterterrorism Center, is another story. Created after 9/11 to fuse terrorism threat reporting across the U.S. government, NCTC has an ultra-modern operations center with giant wall monitors, an open floor plan, and computer stations tracking bad guys around the globe. It looks like it came straight out of Hollywood. Because it did. Government officials actually hired an engineer from Walt Disney Imagineering to design the agency's offices, right down to the sleek consoles and lunchroom chairs. In intelligence, art is imitating life, and life is imitating art. The implications of this shift are far more serious than they appear. In the past two decades, spy-themed entertainment, or spytainment, has skyrocketed, while spy facts remain scarce, and university professors are teaching courses on just about everything other than intelligence. The result? Spy-themed entertainment is standing in for adult education on the subject. And although the idea might seem far-fetched, fictional spies are actually shaping public opinion and real intelligence policy. This chapter begins by exploring how little Americans know about the real-life intelligence world. Next, we trace the rise of spytainment and the complicated relationship intelligence agencies have with Hollywood. Then we take a closer look at how classification policies, the intelligence community's culture of secrecy, and the incentives shaping what university professors study make spy facts hard to find. Finally, we turn to consequences. As we'll see, since 9/11, deep state conspiracy theories have spread like wildfire, many of them accusing intelligence agencies of waging a secret war against our own country, just like they do in the movies. Spytainment is also influencing policymaking elites, not just everyday Americans. From cadets at West Point, to senators on the Intelligence Committee, to Supreme Court justices, policymakers are contemplating Hollywood spies and plot lines to make real policy decisions. Intelligence about intelligence. Most Americans don't know much about the secret world of intelligence because they've never interacted with it. Although many decry the growing gulf between civilians and the all-volunteer force, far more Americans interact with soldiers than with intelligence officers. On a typical American street, military veterans live in 2 out of every 10 houses. But outside the Washington, D.C. area, almost no one lives next door to an intelligence official. Or if they do, they don't know it. Intelligence isn't a big part of Congress either. In 2020, just 18 of the 535 representatives and senators serving in Congress had ever worked in an intelligence agency. In fact, the House and Senate had more doctors in their ranks than former intelligence officers. In 2009, I started hunting for polling data about Americans' knowledge of intelligence, as well as attitudes toward hot-button intelligence issues. There wasn't much, so I decided to gather my own small sample of rough data, surveying UCLA undergraduates enrolled in my class, U.S. Intelligence Agencies in Theory and Practice. This wasn't exactly a ho-hum period for American intelligence agencies. The Iraq War, which began with faulty intelligence, was dragging on into its sixth year. Controversy was still raging about the National Security Agency's warrantless wiretapping program, which collected telephone metadata on millions of Americans and intercepted international communications into and out of the United States of people with suspected links to terrorist organizations, all without court warrants. Meanwhile, the Senate Intelligence Committee was revving up a major investigation of the CIA's detention and interrogation of suspected terrorists at black sites around the world. With all these controversies, I expected protesters outside my class and empty seats inside. But when I walked into the lecture hall the first day, I was surprised to find that it was standing room only. Students, it turned out, were hungry to learn. The class was a wide mix of freshmen and seniors, doves and hawks. privacy activists, and veterans. I asked them why they were taking the course. "I want to know why my buddy died in Iraq," said one. "I want to know why I was there." The room went silent. This student sat in the front row, right side, every class, for the next 10 weeks. The class survey results were illuminating. I learned that my students, even those who followed the news closely, knew almost nothing about intelligence agencies and how they worked. What's more, there seemed to be a disconcerting connection between students' attitudes towards intelligence and spy-themed television. Those who said they always watched the hit show 24, which depicted torture often and favorably, were statistically more likely than their peers to approve of harsh interrogation methods like waterboarding, which simulates drowning and which many regard as torture. Of course, the survey couldn't prove that watching 24 caused these attitudes. My sample size was only about 100, and it was hardly representative. Maybe the show attracted viewers who were more pro-waterboarding all along and enjoyed seeing Jack Bauer do whatever it takes each episode. So in 2012 and 2013, I ran two national surveys through YouGov, a leading polling firm, gathering data from about 1,000 respondents per survey from a nationally representative pool. The YouGov findings ended up echoing my less scientific UCLA student poll and yielded two interesting results. The first is that Americans' knowledge of intelligence is generally poor. To gauge understanding, I asked respondents some basic questions, such as how much intelligence in a typical report was secret, and who was the most senior intelligence official in the United States. I also included some questions about the mission of the National Security Agency in the midst of the Edward Snowden revelations, the agency's biggest crisis since its founding in 1952. To make it easier, I gave respondents options, so they didn't have to come up with answers out of thin air. They just needed to select the right multiple-choice answer. For instance, about what percent of the information in a typical intelligence report comes from secrets? More than 75%? 75%? 50%? 25%? Less than 25%? Not sure? The correct answer is less than 25%. Only about 20% of intelligence in a typical intelligence report comes from classified information or secrets. The rest is gleaned and synthesized from open sources or publicly available information, like foreign government reports and newspaper articles. In the next chapter, we'll talk more about the different kinds of intelligence and what intelligence agencies do with all of that open source information that makes it valuable. The point is, if you got the question wrong, you are not alone. 9 out of 10 Americans, or 93% to be exact, either didn't know how much intelligence in a typical report is secret, or they marked the wrong choice. 25% thought secrets comprise 75% or more of intelligence reports. Nearly half of respondents thought 50% of reports were secrets. Perhaps most interestingly, I found that Americans did not understand what the NSA did, even when media at the time was saturated with news stories about it. In May 2013, Edward Snowden, a former NSA contractor, illegally took and released a massive cache of highly classified documents detailing some of the agency's most important and sensitive collection programs. Among other things, the documents revealed that the NSA was spying on foreign leaders of U.S. allies, collecting millions of Americans' phone records or metadata, and secretly accessing data from tech companies like Google and Yahoo. Snowden became an international sensation when he fled to Hong Kong, then Moscow, and stories based on his materials began appearing in The Washington Post, The Guardian, The New York Times, and Der Spiegel. Despite being in hiding and on the run, his face was everywhere. In the 6 months following the first disclosure, Snowden appeared in 395 articles in the New York Times and 716 articles in The Guardian, the newspaper that initially broke the story. He later gave television interviews to Brian Williams at NBC News, John Oliver on HBO's Last Week Tonight, and Trevor Noah on Comedy Central's The Daily Show. The Justice Department charged Snowden with violating the Espionage Act of 1917, and the State Department revoked his passport. Snowden's revelations generated tremendous controversy. Although a presidentially appointed bipartisan review panel found no evidence of illegality or other abuse of authority within the NSA programs he disclosed, Congress came under heavy pressure to more narrowly circumscribe the telephone metadata program, which it ultimately did. Many privacy advocates viewed Edward Snowden as a whistleblowing hero, while many national security officials viewed him as a traitor. When I asked former NSA Director Michael Hayden what he would ask or say to Snowden if he saw him, Hayden immediately answered, "You have the right to remain silent." Yet according to my October 2013 survey, which was fielded in the middle of the Snowden media frenzy, most Americans didn't even know what the NSA did for a living. The crisis was unfolding against a backdrop of widespread public misperception and ignorance. The NSA, which employs about 40,000 people, is one of America's most important organizations. The agency intercepts and analyzes foreign signals intelligence, including email, telephone calls, and encrypted data transmissions. The NSA is also, as its website declared, home to America's code makers and code breakers. This code making and breaking mission is essential for protecting information like U.S. nuclear codes and for penetrating foreign communications. My survey asked respondents whether they thought the NSA conducted any of the following six activities: code breaking, intercepting foreign communications, analyzing information, building spy satellites, interrogating terrorist detainees, and conducting operations to capture or kill foreign terrorists. The first three were true. The second three were false. The survey found that most Americans didn't know the difference. Only half of respondents knew that the NSA is responsible for making and breaking codes. Large majorities harbored either ignorance or misperceptions about other aspects of the NSA's mission. Americans' ignorance about the NSA wasn't an outlier. I found that even major events in the intelligence community don't always register with the public. During the week of September 3, 2009, the CIA released a landmark report about the use of waterboarding and other controversial interrogation techniques. But only 3% of Americans said that was the news story they followed most closely that week. When Facebook listed the top 40 most shared news stories of 2011, the killing of Osama bin Laden, one of the greatest intelligence successes in history, did not even make the list. Findings from my 2012 and 2013 YouGov polls also resonated with my less scientific student survey about the real influence of fictional spies. I found that the more frequently American viewers watched spy-themed TV shows and movies, the more likely they were to support aggressive counterterrorism tactics, including assassination, harsh interrogation techniques against suspected terrorists, and NSA surveillance of American citizens. Here are just a few examples of the statistically significant results from my 2012 YouGov poll. Assassination. 84% of frequent spy TV watchers were willing to assassinate known terrorists versus 70% of infrequent watchers. Rendition. 60% of frequent spy TV watchers thought that transferring suspected terrorists to a third-party country known for using torture, a practice called rendition, was right, versus 45% of infrequent watchers. 53% of spy moviegoers supported transferring suspected terrorists to a country known for using torture versus 41% of non-moviegoers. Waterboarding. 38% of frequent spy TV watchers believe that waterboarding suspected terrorists, which involves strapping someone on a board and forcing water into their cloth-covered nose and mouth until they think they are drowning, was the right thing to do, versus 28% of infrequent watchers. My 2013 poll revealed that spytainment viewing habits were also highly correlated with opinions about the NSA. The more people watched spy-themed television shows and movies, the more they liked the NSA, the more they approved of NSA's telephone and internet collection programs, and the more they believed the NSA was telling them the truth about its surveillance activities. In many instances, the differences in opinion between spytainment viewers and the rest of the country were large. The statistically significant findings include these. NSA favorability. 58% of people who frequently watched spy movies in the previous year had favorable views of the NSA, but only 34% of infrequent spy moviegoers reported favorable views of the agency. Approval of NSA surveillance programs. 44% of people who watched spy TV shows frequently or occasionally said they approved of the NSA's internet data and telephone records collection programs. But only 29% of those who rarely or never watched spy TV shows approved of these programs. NSA telling the truth. 23% of frequent or occasional spy TV watchers believe the NSA was telling them the truth about not listening in on telephone call content in the agency's metadata collection program, compared to just 15% of infrequent spy TV show watchers who thought the NSA was telling the truth. Whatever one thinks about these activities, whether they are effective or ineffective, morally right or morally wrong, the fact that fiction may be significantly influencing public attitudes about them is unsettling. Of course, in academia, we often warn that correlation is not the same thing as causation. It could be that entertainment merely reinforces or reflects beliefs that people already hold. Just because two things trend together doesn't mean one causes the other. Superstitious sports fans wear lucky t-shirts, but nobody really thinks the fashion choices of viewers determine which team wins the game. In this case, however, there is good reason to believe the relationship between spytainment and beliefs could be causal. We know that entertainment has influenced popular culture and attitudes on plenty of other subjects. In the 1980s, law school applications skyrocketed when L.A. Law became a hit television show. Prosecutors have bemoaned the CSI effect, how the popular television show has led jurors to expect fancy forensic evidence in court and to assume the government's case is weak without it. And the 1986 blockbuster, Top Gun, became a Navy recruiting bonanza, boosting enlistments and applications to the Naval Academy. Top Gun made the Navy so popular, recruiters even began setting up tables outside movie theaters. As one columnist wrote, America fell in love with Maverick, Iceman, and other high-five and silver-screen superpilots as they traveled Mach 2 while screaming about the need for speed. If art can affect life in the legal profession, criminal investigations, and the military, it's not much of a stretch to imagine the same thing could be happening in intelligence. Evidence suggests that it does. Spytainment has ballooned in the past 20 years, becoming the predominant and often only way for Americans to understand the intelligence agencies that serve them. The rise of spytainment. Spy-themed entertainment is everywhere these days. In Robert Ludlum novels, Tom Clancy video games, movie franchises like Bond and Bourne, and hit television shows like Homeland and 24. To be sure, spies have been big business for a long time. James Bond first appeared in Ian Fleming's 1953 novel, Casino Royale, and has been around so long that 7 different actors have played him on the big screen. Tom Clancy's CIA hero, Jack Ryan, first appeared in his 1984 best-selling novel, The Hunt for Red October. And Jason Bourne first forgot his shady CIA past back in 1980, when Robert Ludlum published The Bourne Identity. In fact, America's first ever best-selling novel was a fictional account of a double agent during the Revolutionary War that was published in 1821 and aptly titled The Spy. The difference today is the quantity and variety of spy-themed entertainment surrounding us in a sea of fiction. 100 years ago, American readers first discovered the allure of spy-tainment. Now they can't get away from it. Together, Clancy and Ludlum have sold roughly 400 million books worldwide. Clancy's novels have become such a common part of American culture that during the September 11, 2001 terrorist attacks, CNN anchor Judy Woodruff described the event as something right out of a Tom Clancy novel, and the network interviewed Clancy about the similarities between his book and the 9/11 plot. 10 years later, CNN host Elliot Spitzer used the same Clancy reference to describe the operation that killed Osama bin Laden. Everywhere you turn, fictional spies are there. For kids, there's Alex Rider, Anthony Horowitz's 14-year-old British agent, who has appeared in 12 best-selling books, 5 graphic novels, and his own action figure line. Tom Clancy spy-themed video games helped catapult the U.S. video game industry from a $2 billion business in 1996 to a $43 billion industry in 2018. Spies are cornering a larger share of television and movie audiences today, too. In the 1995-1996 television season, only 2 shows remotely related to intelligence, The X-Files and JAG, made Nielsen's top 100 list for the most watched programs. In the 2005-2006 season, there were 12, a striking 6-fold increase. As households have switched from traditional TV to internet streaming services, spy-themed shows have followed them, with Jack Ryan making his Amazon Prime debut in 2019. Today, Hollywood studios are releasing twice as many spy blockbusters as they did in the 1980s. Real spies have always had a complicated relationship with fictional ones. On the one hand, intelligence agencies have been courting Hollywood for decades in the hopes of getting favorable portrayals. On the other hand, they often decry the negative and unrealistic depictions that often result. No one promoted an agency's reputation in the entertainment industry more assiduously than FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover. Presiding over the Bureau from 1924 to his death in 1972, Hoover was a one-man public relations machine who cooperated only with producers and reporters that portrayed the Bureau in a positive light. By the 1930s, there were FBI-themed movies, radio shows, comic strips, even bubblegum cards. With the onset of the Great Depression, Americans were eager for heroes, escapism, and the triumph of good over evil. In 1935, movies regularly featured the FBI, including Warner Brothers' G-Men, starring the biggest tough guy in Hollywood, James Cagney. These films glorified FBI agents as intrepid heroes, guns in hand, who worked the streets to solve crimes and always got their man. Although Hoover was quick to say that he did not officially endorse G-Men, the Bureau was flooded with fan mail after the movie's release. Today, the FBI, CIA, and Defense Department all have public affairs officers or entertainment industry liaisons who work with Hollywood writers, directors, and producers to try to favorably portray their organizations by showing them the inside. In 2008, the FBI sponsored a special public relations seminar called FBI 101 for the Writers Guild of America. The CIA has developed and pitched its own list of storylines for screenwriters to consider. The Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines have deployed to Los Angeles, setting up entertainment liaison offices there. At Langley, movie posters decorate the public affairs conference room. In 2004, the CIA had Alias actress Jennifer Garner appear in a recruitment video. For years, the CIA's kids' website featured a cartoon spy named Junior Officer Ava Shufone, who wore bright red lipstick and a trench coat and spoke through a secret telephone embedded in her high-heeled shoe. The agency even named its venture capital firm Incutel after Q, the gadgets master from James Bond. Former CIA General Counsel Jeffrey Smith told National Public Radio, "We really needed something that also had appeal to a wider audience and, frankly, had some sex to it." At the same time, the CIA dislikes the sinister depictions of agency life that ride shotgun with all the Hollywood glamour. In 2006, Robert De Niro starred in a film about the CIA's early days called The Good Shepherd. CIA officials were hoping it would be for the agency what Flags of Our Fathers was for the Marines, a glamorous glimpse of the country's unsung heroes. Instead, the movie tells a dark and disturbing fictionalized account of how a spy catcher named Edward Wilson, a character based very loosely on the CIA's dark and disturbing counterintelligence chief, James Jesus Angleton, loses his soul while serving his country. The film's only heroic figure was a Soviet KGB officer. CIA officers eventually published a history roundtable about the film, and needless to say, they weren't fans. Perhaps no movie captures the risks that arise when Hollywood writes history, like Zero Dark Thirty, the Academy Award-nominated film about the CIA's 10-year hunt for Osama bin Laden. The film received significant assistance from the CIA and portrays the agency in a very flattering light. According to declassified documents, CIA officials met with movie makers on repeated occasions, reviewed draft movie scripts, and provided access to a number of key people involved in the hunt for bin Laden. Yet when the movie was released, it generated so much controversy about what was real and what wasn't that CIA acting director Michael Morell had to issue a memo to the CIA workforce clarifying the facts. The film takes significant artistic license while portraying itself as being historically accurate, Morell wrote. "What I want you to know is that Zero Dark Thirty is a dramatization, not a realistic portrayal of the facts." Morell didn't stop there. His memo directly disputed the movie's central claim that harsh interrogation methods were pivotal to tracking bin Laden to his compound in Abbottabad, Pakistan. The film creates the strong impression that the enhanced interrogation techniques that were part of our former detention and interrogation program were the key to finding bin Laden. "That impression is false," Morell wrote. The truth is that multiple streams of intelligence led CIA analysts to conclude that bin Laden was hiding in Abbottabad. Some came from detainees subjected to enhanced techniques, but there were many other sources as well. This was a big deal. Both the efficacy and morality of harsh interrogation techniques have been the subjects of intense debate, with defenders arguing that these methods produced some useful information that contributed to finding bin Laden, and critics emphasizing how harsh interrogations produced false and misleading information that hindered progress and raised deep ethical concerns. Reality is nuanced. The movie was not. The result was deeply misleading. Yet writer Mark Boll and director Catherine Bigelow marketed Zero Dark Thirty as a faithful reporting of the facts, calling it a reported film and a docudrama. The film's opening frame declares that it is based on firsthand accounts of actual events. These are strong words. Bigelow kept using them, repeating the based on firsthand accounts mantra as she defended her film in the press. She even used them when she went on the comedy show The Colbert Report. It was a surreal moment, a filmmaker masquerading as a journalist, telling a comedian masquerading as a news anchor that her fictional film, masquerading as a documentary, was a first draft of history. Under fire, Bigelow eventually claimed that Zero Dark Thirty was just putting it out there for others to debate the issues. As she wrote in the Los Angeles Times, "Those of us who work in the arts know that depiction is not endorsement. Those of us who work in the academy know something else. Too often, depiction is shoddy education." In search of spy facts. While spy fiction has become ubiquitous, spy facts remain scarce. The intelligence community acknowledges the problem and has taken important steps to make more information public in recent years. Still, new technologies, outdated classification policies, and the intelligence community's enduring culture of secrecy have made official information about American intelligence agencies hard to come by, while creating a bizarre information universe that is technically classified but widely known. The effect is a confusing labyrinth where it's hard to untangle what's real and what isn't. Overclassification, declassification, and reclassification.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.